Dr. Mark Strom, tell me, why do CEOs come to your group and what's your specialty?
I think they would all say they want to grow, and they would all say they want to accelerate that growth, particularly as leaders. So it's not so much about improving the bottom line of the business as such, but really, in a sense, it's the bottom line of them. It's who they are as leaders, character, their ability to sit present, their ability to be attentive to life, attentive to the business, attentive to themselves.
It takes a certain amount of maturity for a CEO to admit that it isn't just about the bottom line and profitability, but that they themselves are on a journey to improve. Do you think that they are in any way shy to admit this, that they need this personal improvement?
It varies. I think, to me, the key character trait of someone who'd want to be there is humility. You know, I think that's where learning starts. A person who's arrogant has a sense in which life has nothing to teach them and no one else has anything to teach them. But humility has that lovely sense of an openness to life that says, you know, I don't know everything. And no matter who these people are in the room, I can learn from them. And I think everyone who comes has some dimension of that. Sure, you're going to have varying degrees of ego. You're going to have varying degrees of people being comfortable with acknowledging that. You'll have some people that'll come that will be quieter, others that'll be more boisterous to begin with. But there is that common denominator of I'm there because I want to learn and I acknowledge I don't know everything.
Mark, in business, people rattle phrases and concepts off the tongue. They talk about productivity, innovation, leadership. But you say, hang on a minute, before we can even discuss those topics, we have to wonder what the real pertinent core questions are about leadership, about productivity and innovation. Do you think people need to be convinced about that way of thinking? Because you talk about questions. Don't most people think, hang on a minute, I can ask questions?
No, I find I don't need to convince them at all. And I'm very deliberate about not using business jargon, and which some people may find that a little disarming initially, but generally speaking, not at all. It's quite refreshing to people to drop those sorts of terms. In fact, I did a little exercise with a group recently where I had them just get a sheet of paper and write down in the most normal management speak they could a word for each of the areas of expertise that they carry. And then what I'd asked them to do was to, using very, very plain words, turn that management noun, whether it was marketing or strategy or whatever it was, turn that into a very plain question. And what came out of the exercise was that just about everybody found it incredibly difficult. And the next stage of the exercise, almost excruciatingly so, which was to try and frame a question for what sat between the disciplines. And at the end of the exercise, we actually went back to it in a second month when we were together, and the group was saying, this was really difficult, but I realised that this is what I've got to learn to do. I've got to learn to step outside of the jargon, step outside the obvious ways of describing who I am in my business and where I find myself, and learn how to think about this in ways which, at the one hand, are the sorts of things which open up the possibility of innovation, but they're also very plainly human.
I believe you've authored a book.
The book's called Lead with Wisdom, and it's been the hypothesis of all of my work now for probably nearly 30 years, is the basic idea that I think leadership needs wisdom, and that many of the questions we want to ask about what it means to lead well, we can actually get to a better place, a richer place, by, in a sense, putting to one side the question of leadership just initially and asking instead, what does it mean to be wise? And it doesn't, contrary, some people think that leads you into a kind of an esoteric conversation, but it actually doesn't. It's an ages-old conversation across all of human history and human cultures, and it's actually a very grounded and very practical question. And when we establish some sense of the patterns of human life and human experience, and start to get a handle on how I address things like the way language works and the ways people shape meaning, how it is that dialogue is where we construct new ideas, getting a sense of how the human will holds itself, in the face of adversity and complexity and whatever, you realise these are actually the really fundamental things that every leader, every manager is facing. But we can find a way to have the conversation without the corny formulas and the cliches, and people seem to really welcome this. I do a really simple thing to begin this, and I did it in the 2020 groups, which is I always go back to people's own stories. So while I bring a lot of my own background and experience and background in history and philosophy. What I'm convinced of is that the brilliance is in the room. And I'm just one of those people who bring that. And so, and that brilliance is accessed through stories. So one of the things I do with the group is ask them to remember, to think of a person in their own life that they would consider to be wise. They may never have used the word before, but once they think of the person, they realize, yeah, the word actually fits. And I get them to think about a time that they're very grateful for that person. And you've only got to do this for a little while and then share. And before you know it, you've put together a wonderful kind of tapestry of images about what it is to be wise. And you realize that this isn't esoteric or irrelevant. This is actually deeply, deeply right on target for what it is to lead today in any organization.
How calming and liberating it must be if we can actually merge the wisdom of which you speak with the questioning process that you speak about before we start running off and trying to find solutions.
Yeah, absolutely.
That, I think, is certainly exciting and liberating. Dr. Mark Strom, thank you very much for joining us today.
It's been a pleasure, Jonah.